What's up, YouTube? Ryan Panny here. Hope you guys are doing reasonably well. Welcome back to the latest year-end lists probably to ever hit the internet. It's good to be back. Again, so sorry for the delay, but I am proud to say, though, that these lists, which this one will actually be a top 25 if you watch to the end of the video for honorable mentions, these lists are anything but off the cuff. I've spent a lot of time thinking about these and narrowing picks down. I feel like I've got an awesome mishmash of metal subgenres for this list, and an even more exciting and diverse group for the non-metal video, which will be coming in a few days. Yeah, I always like to separate the metal world from the rest of the music industry, because in my experience at least, they really are two different entities and two different industries, with metal being a lot more independent and self-sustaining, and the rest of music being a little more incestuous, as it were. God, there were a lot of good metal records this year, and I struggled, as I always do, to narrow this down, but I feel like I got a really good list here, and if you're a metal guy, please, please be sure to check out any of these records I talk about that you haven't heard yet, because odds are they'll make a positive impact on your life. Again, definitely watch to the end of this video for all the honorable mentions, and let's dive right into it. Number 10, a fantastic black and death metal record, Necrophobic with Mark of the Necrogram. To me, this record just represents exactly what I want from the worlds of black metal and death metal colliding. It was one of the first records of 2018 to really wow me early on in the year, and that just sustained for the rest of the year to the point where I'm listening to it in December, making this list, and my love for it had not wavered whatsoever. So if you're like me and behemoth records like Satanica or The Satanist or Thelma 6 are like the Bible to you for this type of metal, you're gonna love this record. 9, Rivers of Nile, Where Owls Know My Name. What a fucking surprise this was. Honestly, I wouldn't blame anyone for putting this record even higher up on their list. It's just such a unique fusion of bludgeoning, meticulously produced death metal, which for the record is not really a category I normally enjoy, with a little prog, a lyrical concept, God forbid, and a little bit of saxophone, which was widely talked about in the metal community and evidently goes a long way for critics. You just add a foreign instrument and all of a sudden the record's really cool. No, but this is a wonderfully multidimensional extreme metal record. This is a great chance for you to really bust whatever misconceptions you have about modern, sort of proggy, noodly death metal. There are moments on here where that over-the-top bottom end starts to grate on me a little bit just from a production standpoint, but that doesn't stop this from being really one of my favorite death metal records of the past few years. I think any respectable year-end 2018 metal list will include Rivers of Nile somewhere in there. The very underrated Gorod come in at number 8 with Ethra, came out in October. Still classifiably tech metal, as Gorod had always been, but this time around, toning down that technicality piece ever so slightly in favor of a set of snappier, hookier tracks. The fact that this record was written in like 6 weeks or something like that probably has something to do with that, in addition to just being really impressive. This one, of any of the records on this list that I'll be talking about, this has got to be the most frustratingly underrated record that I will discuss here, just in terms of me combing through other year-end metal lists and seeing it conspicuously absent. I just wish people gave this more of the love and attention that it deserves, because it's fucking phenomenal, as Gorod's music always is. Number 7, this one came out all the way back in January 2018, but I didn't catch it until over halfway through the year, the awesome Tribulation record Down Below. Just a delightful, delightful melting pot of black metal with some gothic metal, as well as some nods to some old school new wave of British heavy metal stuff. God, have I been really pushing this record on people. My favorite thing about it, which has also been a constant selling point for me, is that the production just sounds nothing like any other modern metal bands. This thing is so elegantly underproduced, if that makes sense. Like, the compositions themselves are layered and even cinematic at times, but the actual sound is never overblown, it's never overproduced, everything just feels so live and so raw. I just love to wrap myself up in the sound of this record more than anything. Yeah, you gotta check this record out if you haven't yet. Okay, just missing the top 5 is Between the Buried and Me with Automata. I'm combining parts 1 and 2, which are cohesive but were released separately, one in March and one in July. Everybody and their mother talked so much shit about how this record shouldn't have been split up and should have been released as one record, and I just cannot begin to describe how much I disagree with that statement. With 2018 attention spans, splitting this thing up into 2 half-hour was fucking genius. If you watched my mid-year list from 2018, you'll remember that I loved part 1, and I also loved that I just had enough time to absorb it, dissect it, and then anticipate a second installment. Anticipate a continuation of the story, but not have to wait like 2 or 3 years. I don't know, maybe my IQ just isn't high enough, but I feel like being bludgeoned with this dense concept record all at once might have been a lot to handle. I love that I had time in between to kind of sit and think on it. And you know, musically speaking, sonically speaking, as a longtime fan of this band personally, it was amazing to hear them get back to heavier stuff after 2015's prog rock detour, Coma Ecliptic, which is a record that I did not like. I'm usually supportive of softer, more melodic directions, but you know what I found listening to this record is Between the Bear and Me really thrive on that over-the-top, everything-but-the-kitchen-sink approach to songwriting and to progressive metal, and the heaviness factor is a key component of that, and to see them rediscover that was wonderful. I think that in time, I don't know, other BT BAM fans will probably crucify me for saying this, but I think that in time, this record will be looked upon with as much favorability as Alaska, or maybe not Colors, but Between the Bear and Me's better works. Let's just put it that way. Number five, gonna give to Drud Ka Huh, or however you say it. The rough translation from Ukrainian is they often see dreams about the spring. This epic, sweeping, atmospheric black metal record was an absolute cornerstone of 2018 for me, and I mean across all music. I, believe it or not, actually listened to this record more than any other record that's on this list. And what I loved so much about it, and still do, is it's one of those epic, long-winded black metal records that you can kind of put on in the background and basically treat like one long composition and kind of just let it run. In sharp contrast to records I've talked about, like Between the Bear and Me, where it's extremely nuanced and requires a lot of attention and brain power. This is the opposite. This is a mood record. Throughout 2018, I did so much journaling, just writing in general, driving, working out, thinking. With this album in the background, just kind of drifting in and out of being enveloped by the massive anthemic melodies that this band performs. I suppose in that sense it's a very specific type of listen, but in the general sense it just highlights what I love about this style of black metal. How it can kind of become a passive soundtrack to your life and your thoughts, whatever those might be. At number four, the ever so controversial and hateable Deaf Heaven with Ordinary Corrupt Human Love. This record is beautiful. Just totally singular from any of the other records that I'm gonna talk about. This band's grand, often sorrowful fusion of the agonizing pain of black metal with the serene melancholy of the indie rock world. To me, on this record, they reach greater depths. Similar to the Drud Ka record, this is another one that I could put on in the background, especially on gray days, days when I was feeling down, and just kind of let it play. And I just feel like there's no metal band out there right now that finds beauty and sadness quite like Deaf Heaven does. And this record had an immense emotional impact on me throughout the second half of the year. You know, people who have been dismissing this band's distinct Americanized form of black metal for close to a decade now, they've got to give up their crusade at some point and admit the talent in this band. You don't have to like it, but I do, so fuck you. Making it all the way to number three, Sluggage with Esoteric Malacology. This band should be way bigger. Goofy lyrical concepts aside, they offer a truly dazzling slab of extreme metal with Esoteric Malacology, which is their fourth and best LP. Highly recommended for fans of death metal, especially those of you who prefer intricate musicianship and a lot of subgenre co-mingling, as it were. Like, I couldn't even necessarily, in good conscience, classify this as a death metal record purely. And especially from a guitar standpoint, in my opinion, this is the best written and best performed guitar album I heard in metal for the entire year. I'm just really impressed with this band's technical ability, their surprisingly catchy songwriting, and I'm impressed with how everyone's been able to ignore them. This should be a massive band, and I hope to see them continue to scale new heights off the back end of this excellent album. Our silver medal here goes to At the Gates to Drink from the Night Itself. I know I'm swimming uphill here with this being as high as it is on this list. I'm well aware of that, but you should definitely go watch my review of it that I did back when it came out, because I think I made some salient points that still resonate with me when I watch it now. You know, one of the biggest complaints that metalheads had about this record was that it was underproduced and the production was kind of muddy. But me, I thought that the record having more of a raw sound to it hugely added to the listening experience. And in contrast with the band's 2014 comeback record At War With Reality, which was awesome, but was more or less a relatively safe and conscious rehashing of classic At The Gates material that everyone wanted to hear, To Drink From The Night itself, it's combining that Slaughter of the Soul era At The Gates with some other sounds, God forbid. You know, the Mirror Black, which is a great closing track here. It has more of like a halftime black metal march to it. Colors of the Beast has that old school death metal vibe to it. And that's what wowed me here. This was a surprisingly diverse and well-rounded set of tracks from this veteran metal act and one of my personal favorite bands ever. So I enjoyed having the minority opinion on this one because it was just, I could not stop listening to it from the moment it came out to now. It's still on all the time. And numero uno, as with my mid-year list that I did 6 months ago now, nothing's changed, giving it to Amorphis, Queen of Time. Nothing from the second half of the year unseated this record. Just listen to it. I have so much praise, I'm not even gonna be able to get it out, for this prog slash folk slash power metal record. I don't even know how to properly label it, which is probably why it's so high. It's got a little bit of everything. Soaring melodies, chunky riffs, it's got a concept to it, which is about bees. No, seriously, about bees. It's a record that I know I'm always gonna be able to count on to give me that epic, triumphant, arms stretched out feeling that this brand of metal delivers. From the opening track, The Bee, to just the minute it opens, all the way through the end, there is not a skippable moment on here. If you prefer your metal brutal and indecipherable though, this is not for you. The sound of this record is relatively clean. It's tuneful, it's very coherent, very polished without being too polished. It's unabashed in its celebration of melody and corny melody, which is my favorite kind of melody. It's definitely a record for your open-minded non-metalhead friends. Never thought I'd see an Amorphis album on here, but they blew me away with Queen of Time. And now I feel like I gotta go back in their discography and make sure I didn't miss a gem in there somewhere. So that's it. Hope you guys enjoyed this list. Non-metal albums coming very soon. Songs That Define the Year coming very soon. Of course, honorable mentions for this list, the remaining 15, coming right up. Stay tuned for that. And as always, thanks so much for watching, guys. If you enjoyed this video and are not yet subscribed to my channel, please consider doing so by clicking right over here, or just checking out any of the other rock and metal related content that I publish on a weekly basis again now. Really appreciate your support, liking, commenting, subscribing, disliking, anything you can do to interact means the world to me. Follow me on Twitter, Instagram, handles Ryan Panty Music, and I will see you guys soon. No phones inside the telly, pics inside the celly, baby, you know the house rules. Yeah, respect over a dollar, death before dishonor, partner, you know the house rules. If I'm up, you can't be down, and I'm down to tear shit up for you, homie, you know the house rules. Yeah, all bitches with flat stomachs, no cars under 100, my nigga, you know the house rules. I'm high, chillin' with Bruno on Mars, quickest verses, put them in hearses, call them funeral bars.